ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا بين يدي الساعة من يطع الله ورسوله فقد رشد ومن يعصيهما فلا يضر إلا بنفسه ولا يضر يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما يا أيها الذين آمنوا خذوا الحسنى مكانا ولا تتبعوا خطوات الشيطان إنه لكم عدو مبين Indeed, it's a blessing of Allah, the Creator, the Controller, and the Master of the Universe, that we have come together to remind ourselves, إِنَّ هُدَى اللَّهِ وَالْهُدَى. But the guidance is the guidance that comes from God. And He assured us, وَإِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكَ مِنِّي هُدًى فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. Whenever you grasp that guidance and whenever you feel that that guidance makes sense to you and you follow that guidance, you have nothing to worry and nothing to fear in your life. And this was the simplest message that God Almighty shared with humanity through His messengers. But the one who ensured that each and every word of that message is preserved in writing is the one whom we call Rahmatul Lil Alameen, or the mercy to the worlds, of Prophet Muhammad, Mustafa Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Because he is the only messenger and prophet in the whole biblical and Islamic sense who ensured that each and every word of what he was claiming was being revealed from God is written down and is kept in memory in his own lifetime, under his supervision and under his guidance. He reminded us that each one of us will leave this world regardless of our age and health, and a day will come when we will be raised once again to be held accountable for what we have done in this world. And then he also told us that those who act in a responsible manner, who are conscious of the divine guidance and who act on the basis of that consciousness, would indeed succeed in this life and the life hereafter as well. Inna lil muttaqeena mafaza. I'm sure that many of you must have heard a debate among Muslims about the legitimacy of the birthday of the Prophet. Some people say that we should celebrate, some people say we should not celebrate. And the discussion and the conflict reaches to a level where the parties involved in the discussion often condemn the other for doing or not doing for what they were supposed to do. And the whole month of Rabiul Awwal, which is this month, which is the second month of the Islamic lunar calendar, is turned into this kind of heated debate among Muslims in different parts of the world. Even though the methodology of the Quran is very clear in resolving those differences. In tanazatum fi shay'in faruddu ila Allah wa Rasul wa uli al-amr minkum. That when you find yourself in this situation of disputes and this, you can't go back to the Quran, the guidance of God, look at the life of the Prophet, and also go to those people who are knowledgeable, who are the people of authority. And then what happens is that the conflict reaches to a level where the real character and personality of the Prophet is pushed aside, and the conflict becomes overpowering and overbearing. People talk about it, not about the life of the Prophet, not about the contributions that he made, not about his character, talk about his personality. And the whole purpose is defeated. Let us look at this issue from the perspective of the Prophet himself. One of the greatest contributions of the Prophet was to bring together all the factional warring tribes of Arabia. And that was the most important contribution that the Prophet made in the real sense of the term, in addition to, of course, bringing them to the idea of monotheism. But how he did it, that is something that is worth noticing. When you look at the description of prophets in either the Bible or the Old or New Testament or the Quran, you see two patterns. One, there are prophets who were given prophethood either during their childhood, such as Zakaria or Isa, alayhi salatu wasalam, who were told that they have been given this prophethood. Or majority of the biblical and the Quranic prophets, and whose names are mentioned, became prophet as a result of their progeny. They were either the sons or the cousins or the uncle of some of the prophets. And what happened is that all of them made the claim first that they are the prophets. And then they shared the message. They said that they are the prophets. And they shared the message. In the case of Prophet Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the situation is reversed. In the first case, we all know that you first propounded hypothesis and then you basically use empirical facts to determine the validity of those hypotheses and then a theory develops. And almost everything. But in the case of the Prophet Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he first offered his life. And then that life was validated by the divine guidance. It's a major, major shift. Because the Quran says, فَقَدْ لَبِسْتُ فِيكُمْ عُمْرًا مِنْ قَبْلِهِ أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. When the Prophet is being criticized and accused of saying what he was saying, the response of the Prophet is that look at my life that I have spent amongst you. And you decide and you determine whether what I was saying makes sense or does not make sense. And this is not the life as a prophet. This is the life from his childhood until the time he was sharing the message. In other words, he is offering his entire life and his entire character and his entire personality as a evidence of the message and the validity and the legitimacy and the usefulness of the message that he is sharing with the people. This is a unique pattern that we see. In other cases, it is the claim first and then the theory. Here in the case of the Prophet, it's the practice and then, or empirical evidence first and then the theory or the ideas. And when we look at that, thing that we find that it is consistent. It is consistent. And I'll give you a few examples later. But few things that needs to be mentioned in the very beginning. Our writers have not done much justice with the life or recording the life of the Prophet. His life often is presented in the context of the wars or in the context of the fightings. In fact, the earlier Islamic literature that deals with the life of the Prophet focuses on those aspects which they call maghazis, fighting. The fact is that in the 10 years that the Prophet lived in Medina, there were 83 skirmishes or engagements with non-Muslims. In 41 he participated personally. In the rest he did not. In all the these 83 skirmishes, the total number of people who were killed, as has been documented by one of the great scholars of Islam in the last century who died in 2001, the total number of people who were killed, note that number, is 478. Out of those 478, 268 were Muslims and the rest were non-Muslims. 478, total number of people who were killed in those battles. Those who have presented Islam as a violent religion, those who have presented Prophet Muhammad as a prophet of war, those who has presented Prophet Muhammad as a prophet of conflict, should look at this number. 478 in the last century. We killed 153 million people to bring about democracy in the world. And still, we have not succeeded fully in that project. But in 23 years, he succeeded in implementing each and everything that he was saying with this loss. Another fact that needs to be remembered is that the Prophet lived for 198,000 hours. Total, if you calculate the numbers. And again, according to the research, and he has given detailed research, the actual number of hours the Prophet was present in the battlefields, not while in preparation, not while going and coming back from the wars and the battlefields, actual number of hours that he was present in the battle is 17 and a half hours. 0.001% of his entire living hours. So where did he spend the rest of the life? What did he do? And that explains that the person who started as one, calling people to believe in God and calling people to act in a justful manner, that when he left this one, when he was one, but when he left this world, despite the fact that he was asked to leave his own town, that when he left this world, his followers controlled 3 million square kilometers, and they include 1 million people, with only 17 and a half hours in the battlefield. How did it happen? It happened because of character, because of personality, because of the peaceful nature of the messages. It happened because he propagated something that was missing at that particular time, and that was the idea of equality of humanity, unity of humanity, respect and dignity of human beings. And few incidents would explain his character, giving the most ordinary ones. Many are of the norm. Even before when he became the prophet, when he was 32 years of age, a caravan came to Mecca, and one of the chiefs of the tribes of Quraysh abducted a girl belonging to one of those tribes. The chief went from door to door knocking and pleading for the release of his daughter, and no one came because involved the chief of the Quraysh. When the Prophet heard about it, and even though he was not the Prophet, he was not mandated to basically stand for all those things, he stood up outside the tent of that person who was accused of abducting that girl, and said that if that girl is not released and if any harm is done to her, he would actually engage in fight with that particular person. He would offer his life for her rescue, against his own tribes, against his own people. And of course, when such a bold statement came, they released him. So that is one incident. where he stood for the rights of the weak, he stood for the rights of those people who were denied those rights, and he stood for the righteous. It was another incident from the life of the Prophet. And that also happened in Mecca. And that happened in the early days of his prophethood. That there was a woman who was standing by the Kaaba and pleading and appealing to the people who were passing by to help her carry her goods to her home, because she could not sell many of those things on that particular day. She was pleading. And no one came. Usually nobody comes forward when they see people in these kind of situations. They just pass by. Even in our own environment, we see that. You know, hardly anyone would start helping. Only the most noblest soul would come forward with these kind of things. So this young man came forward, and then he told that, "Mother, I will help you. I'll take your goods." And started walking behind her. She became emotional. And she started praying for this young man. And she said that, you know, you are a very good man, and you are the one who basically should be recognized by the city and by the people, and you should be given the role of leadership and all those kind of things. And then said that, "I would warn you to save yourself from one person who has been contaminating our city for long. He has been taking us away from our own traditions and our own culture. And you should not get with him. And remember that his name is Muhammad, and you should not come close to him." The young man kept quiet, came to her house, he put down the goods there, and started walking. The woman immediately realized that she had asked this person's name, and she did not thank him enough. So she called and said, "Well, thank you very much, but what is your name?" And he said, "Muhammad." Now, imagine the situation in our world today. If anyone makes a comment, adverse comment on the life of the Prophet, or publishes a cartoon, or says anything that is demeaning to the Prophet, conflict starts. People start fighting. People start agitating. This was not the character of the Prophet. This was not the personality of the Prophet. This is not how he wanted. There was another incident from his life. Not very far from Medina, and this happened in Medina. Not very far from Medina. There was a village, small village, and there was a young boy. His name was Ayad, as we read it in several books. He was around 10 years of age. So one day while he's sitting, or he's serving the masters, he hears a story, or he hears that kind of discussion among his masters, that there's a man in Medina who is telling that people are equal. They were ridiculing that idea. And he's saying that every human being deserves a dignified existence, that there is no difference between slaves and masters, and the slaves are not actually the slaves, they are equal to the to other fellow human beings. So this boy, after all, he was a human being. He became a bit excited about this idea. It appealed to him. He was the son of a slave. It appealed to him. So he sought the permission of the master to go to Medina to meet this man. So he walked for 10 miles in the scorching heat of Medina. And by the time he reached Medina, he fell down and became unconscious. And then when he woke up, he saw a person was basically tapping his shoulder, and when he came in conscious, asked him where he was from, because the person said that you appear to be new in this town, the way I haven't seen you before. So he said that I heard that there is a person in this town who tells people that all human beings are equal. And then slaves and masters have no distance in terms of their dignity, and they both are have been bestowed dignity by God himself. I just came to that particular village to see this particular person, but I'm tired now. This man said that, well, I'll take you there. He said, I cannot walk anymore because I'm very tired. He said, I'll take you on my shoulders. He took them there. He took to the place where now stands the mosque of the Prophet. And he said, you will find that person here. So he went inside and then started looking around and asked someone who was sitting there, that where is the man who is talking about all these things? And they said, he's the one who brought you on his shoulder. This shows the character of the Prophet, that how immersed he was in the life of many people, how compassionate and kind he was, and how he cared about if Abu Bakr has a was a wife. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. Perhaps for these reasons that the Quran also describes him, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةً حَسَنَةً, that you are not only mercy to your tribe, your own ethnicity, but you have shown an example through your character for humanity that they can follow, and they could show love and kindness to human beings. And then he's also described as someone who has been sent as a perfection of the character of human beings. The people can look at his character and then see how his character was in dealing with various situations. So, when we engage ourselves in this kind of conflict about the validity and the legitimacy of Milad, we actually miss the major point, and that is the life of the Prophet. It is no different than what happened in Christianity when, in the initial stages, people were debating about the legitimacy of the idea of celebrating Jesus' birthday. They were discussing and debating, well, it is not 25th of December, it is 6th of April, what is 30th of March, and all those kind of debates. And they still do. Various people celebrate it differently. We still have. Some people say it's the 12th of February, some people say the 9th of February. It doesn't matter. It's not that important. What is important is the opportunity to relate and to be in touch with his true character and true personality in a world that is so busy that we often find it hard to connect with our own selves. After all, he is the only one who introduced us to the Quran. The Quran did not come down on its own. It was the Prophet. And it was the legitimacy and the validity of the Prophet and his words that made the earlier people realize that it is the truth. And it works. And then within his own life, he made it work for the people. So if we look at that particular life of the Prophet, we find that kind of example, and then I will just conclude it with giving one more example. The first thing that the Prophet ﷺ did when he came to Medina, in addition to, of course, establishing an educational institution for the people to basically get education in his own mosque, he formulated what can be called the written constitution of Medina. It is referred to as Mithaq Medina. It is comprising of 57 clauses. And it is a treaty, or it is a constitution that brings Jews, pagans, Christians, Muslims together. But the most important thing of that particular clause is something that we really emphasize, and whatever we are doing in our collective life goes against that tradition of the Prophet. There were tribes of Aus, there were tribes of Khazraj, there were Jews, they were Christians, and they were pagans. The treaty was written down. The tribes were asked to take that treaty back to their own tribes to get it verified by their members. And based on their input, the amendments were made. And then they were asked to finally ratify it. Four tribes refused. And they were the Muslim tribes, not the non-Muslim tribes. But what is interesting, their right to refuse, their right to dissent was acknowledged and accepted. That was one of the biggest contributions that you can think at that particular time in that environment, where the words of the king, the word of the monarch, the word of the rulers were supreme. No one can even question them. And where the legitimacy of the Prophet was so strong that people would dare question him, at that particular moment, the right to dissent, right to have an alternative idea, the right to reject was accepted. And until a certain period of time, you know, for almost 6 years, the tribe, four tribes of Aus did not sign that treaty, did not acknowledge the existence of them. The Jews did it, the Christians did it, the pagans did it, the Khazraj tribes did it, but not the Aus. And that is one of the important thing, because it was not just a divine act, it was also the act of a real leader, it was the act of a real person who recognized the mandate that people have the right to think for themselves, people have the right to reject, people have the right to say things that are different even if they come from the leadership. And that is something that we find missing in our Islamic political literature altogether. So when we are looking at the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is from those angles that we need to look at what are the unique contributions that the Prophet made in the way we would interact with each other and we would relate with God. And it is in that particular context we have to look at his life as a whole and study it carefully. Because it is still a source of guidance and a source of emulation for all of us. If we believe that the divine calls him with the perfection in human character, then we should study it from that particular perspective. So let us pray to God Almighty that he enables us to understand and realize the real importance of the life of the Prophet.